Hi folks, welcome back to the Astro Forum channel. Thanks for watching and thanks for tuning in. Today I want to discuss mounts with you. So if you are starting your astrophotography hobby, one question would be, what kind of mount do you want to buy? And on the right hand side for you, on the left hand side for me, I have here the Alt-S mount, or the Altitude Azimuth mount. And on the right hand side, I have the German Equatorial mount. And if you don't like long-winded videos about the details of both mounts, I would just suggest when you get into astrophotography, buy this mount on the left, the German Equatorial mount. I will explain to you why I think that would be the best choice for you. But let's get into the Alt-S mount first, and I will explain to you how it works and why it is also nice to have one if you are just a visual observer, or maybe you want to take videos of the planets or the moon. Then an Alt-S mount is perfectly suited for that. It's also a lot of less hassle to work with an Alt-S mount. German Equatorial mount, if you want to image deep sky objects, this is the mount you want to choose. Okay, so let's get into it. So, like I said before, ALT-S, it stands for altitude and azimuth. And what that does it actually mean? It means that altitude, you can have a go-to Alt-S mount like this one, and you can just press your hand controller and the telescope will move in altitude, up or down. And then we have also here the azimuth, which basically means you can also move the telescope horizontally. And why is this not called horizontal and vertical? Well, azimuth means that actually you can put the Alt-S mount in any kind of position, and then it will draw a 360 circle behind around that position, and these degrees, the 360 degrees, will be your azimuth coordinates. So it is really very easy to set up. You can put up your telescope on the Alt-S mount, and you can actually put it in any direction. When you have a go-to mount, an Alt-S mount like this one, you can just focus on either the moon or a very bright star, and it will automatically tell you to, it will automatically guide to a second star with the star alignment. After you have star aligned to the second star, then you are ready to go, and it will just, from the relative position you put the Alt-S mount on, it will just move to any object in the night sky. So that's perfect, but not for astrophotography, and I will explain why. So hi folks, this is my equatorial mount, and the main difference is here, you can see it here. It has a, let's focus, I think you can see it now, it has a latitude position. So we have here 52 degrees in the Netherlands, a latitude position. And the second thing you notice is that the, let's zoom out. The German equatorial mount is always pointed north towards the North Star, or at least in the northern hemisphere. And this is because you have to align your telescope perfectly with the celestial pole of the Earth. So you have to polar align your scope, and you have to take into account the latitude when using a German equatorial mount. If you're interested in how to set up this mount, I have a video on that. But basically it allows you to accurately track the stars, because the stars in the Netherlands, they describe this curved path, and I will show you. So a German equatorial mount, it allows you to accurately track like this curved path that the stars are describing across the night sky. And I also have an animation video, and I will show you in this animation video why this is important. So let's imagine that you are on the North Pole. You could accurately track your stars with an Alt-S mount. Why? Because the stars are moving in azimuth only, so they're only moving from east to west in this case. At the equator, stars are mainly moving in altitude only. So you see stars going straight up and going straight down. So you would be able to track your stars with an LS mount because you would only be using the altitude motor of your mount. But of course, most of us don't live near the equator and also certainly not near the North Pole. So for most of us, we have another path, and then the LS mount cannot cope with that because let's see here, I am in the Netherlands, it's 52 degrees latitude. And then here you can see that my stars describe this curved path along the sky. And of course, an ALS mount can only move horizontally or vertically and cannot cope with this curved path. An equatorial mount can. Why? Yeah, because it's aligned with the celestial pole. The Earth is a little bit tilted, so it takes that into account. And it also takes into account your latitude. So that's why I would recommend buying an equatorial mount when you start this hobby of astrophotography.
Hi folks, so one very important thing to look for when buying a German equatorial mount or looking for a German equatorial mount is whether or not the mount supports auto guiding. And you see here, I have an auto guide connection functionality in my Celestron Advanced VX, and the cable runs from my mount, the auto guide input runs from the mount to a camera. And this camera is connected to a small telescope. And you see here, I put the telescope and the camera on top of my main imaging train. So this is just the telescope I use for astrophotography. And you have here a filter wheel and a camera. And you see also a second cable here. And this second cable runs, in my case, all the way back to my room. And in my room, I have my computer. And on my computer I have auto guiding software that I use to accurately track the stars, and this allows you to increase your exposure time of your images from maybe 30 seconds or 1 minute to 5 minutes or sometimes 10 minutes depending on where you are, and I will show you how that works in the next video.
So I'm using here a PhD guiding 2.6.5 software program. It's open source, so I think a lot of amateur astronomers are really, astrographers are really, really happy with PhD. What does this program do? Well, it takes pictures of the night sky through this small scope and using the camera attached to it. And you can see it refreshes every 1.5 seconds. And it is actually tracking this star. And when it notices that the star goes a little bit up or a little bit down, it will then send corrections to your right ascension motor that is in your mount. So here you can see the blue lines here. When right ascension is too far down, it will tell the mount to compensate for this by moving that axis a little bit up, more or less. And then we have also the declination. So if the star moves a little bit to the left or the right, it will tell your mount to correct for that movement by correcting the declination axis. That is the red line you see right here. So I think that is very interesting. I would always look for it when buying your first German equatorial mount, even when you are not going to use it right away. I can imagine you first want to get to know your mount, how to set it up, how to perform a star alignment, how to track the stars. But I would really recommend auto guiding as an option, because at one point you want to go from 30 seconds or 1 or 2 minute exposures to 5 minutes or maybe even more, 7 or 10 minute exposures when you're not in the city. And you can do that without having a lot of light pollution. I would highly recommend buying a high quality German equatorial mount that supports auto guiding. Why do we need a long exposure time? Just look at these pictures. I will first I will show you a 30 second picture. You can already see it, I think, but okay, this is a 30 second picture of the Orion Nebula, and also you can see nicely. You can see the core of the Orion Nebula, and you see some the trapezium, actually it's called, so stars that are close to the core of the Orion Nebula, and you also see some nebulosity already surrounding the Orion Nebula, so that is already nice. So when we look at a 60-second picture, you can already see that the nebulosity increases. So we can still see the stars in the, and you can still see the core. Actually, the core is a little bit blown out, but you see more nebulosity surrounding the Orion Nebula because we have increased our exposure time. And what do we have here? It's also a 60-second picture. Bear with me because the images are coming live from the camera to the to my computer. Let's see, can I scroll back? Yes. And so here, yeah, you see that I have to deal with a lot of light pollution, but never mind that. So this is a 120-second picture of the Orion Nebula, and let's stretch it a little bit also. Look, you can hear, you can see that I have planes, okay. but what you can see here is that you can make out even more details, especially from the nebula that surrounds the Orion Nebula. Is that actually a sentence? But anyway, you see that the core now, of course, is blown out because it's very bright. So if you take a 2-minute picture, there are no details left of the core. That's also why I am taking these different exposure time pictures. But you can see that, oh, the nebulosity increases a lot when you increase your exposure time. And I have even a 300-second picture. I will try to... This is my lens, I'm sorry about that. I will show you, okay, this is a 300-second picture taken in H-alpha, by the way. If you stretch this, well, how beautiful is that? I mean, you can see this is a 5-minute exposure time picture of the Orion Nebula, and you can capture actually all of the nebulosity that surrounds the Orion Nebula. And when you look here, you have also, it's a fainter nebula, and you will need to take a little bit more pictures and stack those pictures together in order to get this nebula, the Running Man Nebula, it's called, to have a beautiful image of that nebula. So I hope you already understand now that, yeah, just through these examples, I have shown you that an increased exposure time highly increases the amount of detail you can capture when imaging a deep sky object that is faint. So I also want to make that clear. So when you have a very bright deep sky object, you don't need a long exposure time to image that deep sky object. And I think the Orion Nebula is a nice example because it has a very bright core center, so you can already see that the 30-second picture exposes the center core. But if you want to capture the faint nebulosity surrounding the Orion Nebula, you really would need 120 or even a 300-second picture. Let's see if I can go back to this 300-second picture, this one. So hi folks, it's 2 days later since I've made a video, but you can see here another example of a long exposure time. I'm taking 300, so 5-minute pictures of the Horsehead Nebula right now, nearly under a full moon. So I was actually also interested in seeing whether or not my H-alpha filter would be able to get some details of the Horsehead Nebula, and I'm pretty amazed by it because it's nearly full moon, and I can, if I stretch the one, this is only one picture, I can already make out some details of the Horsehead Nebula. So I hopefully will get enough information to post-process it at one point. But I want to end with mounts. I wanted to show you this, basically. So what I've been working on for the last 2.5 weeks is a new website, an Astroforum website I have tried to make. So when you go to astroforum.space, I thought the .space would be appropriate, you get to my website. It's a long way from being finished, but yeah, when you hit the Astro Blog topic,
Oh, wait, maybe I have to refresh first. But when you hit the Astro blog topic, I have a couple of posts. And yeah, one of the posts is also about getting started. Do you want to, an LTS or an EQ mount? So if you click on that post, you can read up on what I have to say. Basically, I talk, I write about the stuff I also mentioned in this video, but I have some extra examples. For instance, what you can do when you have a long exposure tracking and the right processing tools. I'm basically getting a little bit more into why an equatorial mount is so important. I'm getting a little bit more into what kind of latitude position you are at, and also why it is so important to polar align your telescope. And then I wanted to show you this also. So let's see. I have to scroll up. It's here. So there are a couple of other things. So I already mentioned you want to buy a German equatorial mount, it has to support auto guiding. At least I would strongly recommend you to buy a German equatorial mount that supports auto guiding. But what I did not actually talk about was, I think the last thing that is really important when buying a German equatorial mount is the weight. How much weight can the mount carry? Let's see. I have here basically my own story on this. So here I write, the first thing you have to check is whether the mount is able to carry your telescope and your camera. So it's really important to see what kind of stuff you have, what kind of telescope, what kind of camera. And in my case, I have a lighter refractor. So I have this APO refractor photo line 80 millimeters, and it weighs 3.2 kilograms. And I also, of course, have my imaging camera, and it weighs about half a kilo, 500 grams. I'm sorry, I'm European, so I'm using kilos and grams. I will get back to the pounds thing. And I also have an Orion guide scope. I just showed you the small scope that is on top of my imaging train, and that weighs 700 grams. And then we have another 100 gram for the 120 MP camera that is also attached to the small Orion 50 millimeter guide scope. So all in all, I have about 4.5 kilograms, which equals to about 9.9 pounds. Okay, so you have to look at what kind of maximum payload the German equatorial mount can carry. And then as a general rule, or at least I see that a lot of people use this rule of thumb, you take 70 or 75% of that weight. And why is that? Now, in general, you don't want to max out the payload capacity on your German equatorial mount, because then it is you are pushing the limit, so to say, on what you can actually what the mount can carry. So then it becomes more difficult for your mount to accurately track, and that is really important for astrophotography, as I already mentioned. And okay, so to finish up, I have spent a lot of time on this, and I don't know whether I should continue. So please give me your own opinion. So I have this Astro shop, and basically I am planning on making a comparison. It's just a comparison site where you can look at your mounts, cameras, telescopes, and other gear from across different regions, different high quality web shops. To just see what kind of gear they have and at what kind of price. And so I've already been working on the database for mounts, so I just wanted to show you that. So I think maybe it is also useful when you are buying your first mount and you just want to get an impression of what's out there and how much does it cost. We didn't talk about that also. So I have here a website, Astro Shop, and when you click on mounts, you will get on this, particular site. So Astro Shop mounts still under construction. But what I did is I made a field so you can look at your region. Right now I have North America, basically Amazon.com. I'm planning to include other shops, of course, as well. And I have Europe. Basically, right now I have included astroshop.eu, and I will also include other shops in the future. So you have a lot of different brands also. What kind of brand do you like? I'm not going into that right now, but if you have a particular preference for a brand, maybe you used a similar brand telescope mount or mount before, then maybe you want to opt for a similar brand for your next mount or whatever. So you can choose the brand. Also, whether or not auto guiding is a thing that is included, so I would also press this as yes, of course. You want to include auto guiding when you want to get into astrophotography. And then I have also here the payload capacity, and that is just the maximum payload capacity. Right now I have it in kilograms. I can imagine when you are in the US, you want pounds, so maybe I will consider it. But anyway, if you look at maybe 15 kilograms or 10, I would say maybe you want to start with a mount that weighs at that can take at least 10 kilograms. So that would be about 21, 22 pounds of weight, because as I just showed you, when you have even have a small small refractor and a small camera and maybe a gyroscope on it, it will approach 5 to 6 kilos or 12 pounds basically pretty quickly, and you don't want to max out your payload capacity. So I would say maybe when you really want to get into astrophotography, put at least 10 kilograms, which equals to 22 pounds. And then of course you want also to think about what is your price limit. What do you want to spend on a mount? And in this case I only incorporated new mount. So let's see, if you really are on a tight budget and you want to spend only maybe a maximum of $500 or 500 euros on your mount with auto guiding and with higher than 10 kilogram payload capacity and lower than $500, then you might think, hey, this website is not working, but it is working. you're out of luck. So the mount is also a really expensive piece of equipment. That's why I'm also spending a lot of time explaining this. So maybe up to $1,000. And then you can see here, okay, we have some options here. So we have here the Celestron Advanced VX, which I own. So this is one of the cheaper mounts actually that you can buy. That is fit for astrophotography with a small size telescope, small size camera, because we have here, and I included it in the, how do you call this, in the cards of the telescope. So you can click here and it zooms a little bit in, and then you can see, okay, it supports auto tracking and auto guiding, and all of them basically supports auto tracking, which means that you have the hand controller, and the hand controller can be connected to a PC or a laptop. Yes, so we have here the maximum payload capacity, which is 30 pounds equals to about 13 kilograms. And as I said, so take about 70% of that. What is 70% of 13? Maybe minus 4 or minus 5. So you have about 13, so 8 to 9 kilograms. So you see here that I am actually a little bit on the limit already with my small refractor. So we have here 12 kilograms. It's an Ioptron SAM25P. I don't know, I never used it. But it is an alternative. Ioptron is, I think, it's a relatively new player, and they make a very high quality equipment. So, and here this is also a new one. It was not there 3 or 4 years ago. I just noticed it because I was building this database, the Meet LX85, which is, sometimes it's in dollars because it's a US shop or an American dollar shop, and I have put also the euros, which is basically more or less equal to dollar. So this is, yeah, so if you want to shop in Europe, you can just press Europe. When you shop in North America, you can press North America. And I will add also other regions, but it takes some time. It's, for me, it's a hobby, so please bear with me. I will update you when the shop is more, actually I call it shop, but it's a comparison site. The comparison site is ready. And you have the meat here. So the meat can, this, I'm actually quite impressed by the specs. When I look at, it has auto-tracking, auto-guiding, and it can carry up to 15 kilograms of weight, which is higher, like 2 kilos higher, or what is it, like 3 to 6 pounds more as compared to the other two mounts. So that is nice, but maybe you want to have right like higher than 15 kilograms. That's a really solid mount with auto guiding. Yeah, you also have the meat then own as an only mount that is below 100 that is below 1,000 euros or $1,000. Well, let's see the max price. We don't care about it because we have enough money. Now I don't have it, but maybe you have. Let's see. So we have the Skywatcher Hack 5 Pro SynScan, which I know that this is a popular mount. It has it has been around for a lot of time, and it can actually also carry about 15 kilograms, 33 pounds. So yeah, only in Astro Shop it's a little bit more expensive, like 200 euros more expensive compared to the meat. And then we have the Skywatcher mount. Oh, that's an SEQ. Yeah, sometimes you also have this choice to have a equatorial mount that can also be used as an alt-os mount, which might be interesting because maybe you want to do a combination of deep sky photography and also planets and the moon, and then an alt-s moon is of an azimuth option is very yeah, very nice to have. Just scroll back to the earlier part of the video where I explained that you can put it in any kind of direction and you can just track, and it doesn't have a meridian flip also, I guess, so that's nice. So we have the Skywatcher 6 Pro SynScan, EQ6 Pro SynScan, which is a little bit more expensive. The Orion Atlas, oh, this is actually US dollars. EQG, which can support up to 18 kilos, the Skywatcher EQ6 and up to 20 kilos. Orion, oh, this is again a European shop that also support, has the Orion Atlas, the Astro Shop. So yeah, you can scroll. And then here we have the Ioptron. Now we are getting to the more, even more expensive mounts, so 20 kilograms. But you're then also already at 1600 euros or about $1700, at least at Astro Shop. And we have here the Amazon.com, we have Celestron CGM 2. Yeah, so anyway, most expensive in this case, I have the Celestron mount. There is even, I have included mounts up till now that are up to about $2500, because I think when you want to get started with astrophotography, I think you would, like me, I cannot know what you think, but like me, for me it was a very expensive piece of equipment, and I had to think about how much money I wanted to spend. So first I went for the, like, up to $1,000 max, and then maybe start with a little, with a telescope that is not so heavy. And to support auto guiding, and then you have these options. So anyway, if you have any feedback on this, would this be useful to build this comparison website? What do you want to see on it when we are talking about mounts? All kinds of feedback is greatly appreciated. And with that, I think I have covered all of the basics, at least on what to look for when buying your first mount, and I would still say, so when you're buying your first equatorial mount, when you go into astrophotography, when you start doing astrophotography. So thanks for watching again, and see you later. Bye bye.